It's late 2020, and war has broken out in a place the world had forgotten. A festering conflict has erupted into full-scale fighting. Ground zero is Nagorno-Karabakh, a disputed region in the Caucasus Mountains, fought over by two former Soviet republics, Armenia and Azerbaijan.
This looks like a textbook regional war over territory, over ethnic and national pride, fought while the rest of the world is consumed by the pandemic. But for those who are paying attention, it provides a glimpse into the future.
You can find it right here in the propaganda pumping out from the start of the war. Azerbaijan's border patrol posts this video on its YouTube account just as the conflict begins. The lyrics are a rush of jingoistic fever with a mantra, hate for the enemy. But look carefully and you'll see what makes this conflict a watershed in modern war. Watch out for these trucks in the background. In this shot, you can just about see what's inside. Then, a launch in slow motion. What emerges is not a rocket or a missile. It has wings that are beginning to unfold just before the video cuts away. We can see enough to identify what this is. It's what's called a loitering munition from Israel's state-owned defense manufacturer, IAI. Its modern name, the Harop.
IAI presents Harop.
The company's promotional videos show what loitering munitions can do. Once launched, they fly autonomously to a target area, where they can wait or loiter in the sky for hours, scanning for a target, typically air defense systems. Once they find a target, they don't drop a bomb, but fly right into it to destroy it on impact. It's earned them the nickname Kamikaze drones. In the war over Nagorno-Karabakh, these weapons didn't just make for good propaganda, they made a real difference. Azerbaijan had spent years investing in loitering munitions. Analysis by a US think tank showed that they had more than 200 units across four different models, all of them sophisticated Israeli designs. Armenia had only a single domestically made model with a limited range.
The really important aspect of the conflict in Nagorno-Karabakh, in my view, was the use of these loitering munitions, these so-called kamikaze drones, these pretty autonomous systems.
Ulrike Franke is one of Europe's leading experts on military drones.
They also had been used in some way or form before, but here they really showed their usefulness, militarily speaking, of course. It was shown how difficult it is to fight against these systems.
As Azerbaijan celebrated victory, you could even call Nagorno-Karabakh the first war that was won, in part, by autonomous weapons. Little wonder the Harop was on show that day, and other militaries were paying attention.
Since Nagorno-Karabakh, since the conflict, you could definitely see a certain uptick in interest in loitering munition. We have seen more armed forces around the world acquiring or wanting to acquire these loitering munition.
The Nagorno-Karabakh war amounted to a showcase for autonomous weapons with a clear message, this is the future.
It's a future that's coming at us fast. Ever more advanced models are coming onto the market, designed to hit a wider range of targets and to have greater autonomy from human control. The manufacturer IAI even markets one of its models with the slogan, fire and forget.
Fire and forget. Just think about that. Already today, autonomous weapon systems are being used to detect and destroy targets over long distances without human intervention. And this revolution is just getting started, turbocharged by artificial intelligence.
In the United States, a major report from a National Security Commission on artificial intelligence talks about AI enabling a new paradigm in warfighting and urges massive amounts of investment in the field.
Now, this isn't all about autonomous weapons. There are also many other areas of the military which will be using artificial intelligence.
So one area where we see a lot of AI-enabled capabilities is in the realm of data analysis. So we are gathering all so much data in military operations. Another area which I think is quite promising, but also still relatively removed from the battlefield or from the combat, is logistics. AI can definitely help to make this more efficient, cheaper, better, easier, all of that.
And fueling all of this is an intensifying global competition, which spans all the way from these more prosaic fields to the autonomous weapons we're talking about today.
The Chinese and the Russians have made it very clear that they intend to pursue the development of autonomous weapons.
Martin Rasser, a former analyst at the CIA, covers emerging weapons technology at Washington's leading defense think tank.
And they're already investing heavily in the research and development of those systems.
It's not just the superpowers piling in. Britain's new defense strategy also puts AI front and center. And as we've already seen, Israel is a leader in the autonomous weapons field.
In fact, wherever you look, countries of all sizes are jumping in. No wonder there's talk of this becoming an arms race.
Germany's Foreign Minister Heiko Maas is clear that an arms race is already underway.
We're right in the middle of it. That's the reality we have to deal with.
If anything, this might go deeper than an arms race.
AI is here to stay, and there is a belief among the major powers that this could make a difference on the battlefield in the future. So they are frenetically investing in it.
Indian diplomat Amandeep Singh Gill is the former chair of the UN Government Experts Group on Lethal Autonomous Weapons.
And this is a race, in a sense, which cuts across the military and the civilian fields, because there's also the sense that this is a multi-trillion dollar question. It's about the future of resilient economies.
That is what sets this new era apart from arms races of the past. During the Cold War, the development of nuclear weapons was driven purely by governments and the defense industry. Beyond power generation, there wasn't much commercial use for nuclear technology.
Today, AI is rapidly entering our everyday lives. It may even unlock the phone in your pocket when you hold it up to your face. Now, this creeping ubiquity of AI is important because it means that developments in AI technology cannot be contained. They're bound to bleed across between the civilian and military fields, whether we like it or not.
AI is by definition dual use or multi-use. It can be used in all kinds of ways. It really is an enabler more than a technology. There is a whole range of applications of artificial intelligence in the civilian realm, you know, from healthcare to self-driving cars to all kinds of things.
It means that something as innocuous as a New Year's celebration in Edinburgh or St. Patrick's Day in Dublin can be powered by similar swarming technology to what the Indian Army showed off on its National Day. In fact, swarming is one of the hottest areas of autonomous weapons development right now.
5, 4, 3.
The US Navy has released footage of early demonstrations. Here, fighter jets drop over 100 tiny drones in mid-flight. Once they're out there, it's almost impossible for the human eye to keep track of them. The whine of their motors, almost the only sign of the threat in the sky. Experts say they will make highly effective weapons.
You could take out an air defense system, for example, by just, you throw so much mass at it, so many numbers that the system is overwhelmed. This, of course, has a lot of tactical benefits on a battlefield, and you know, no surprise, a lot of countries are very interested in pursuing these types of capabilities.
Not least, the head of the body advancing the U.S. Army's modernization, as he explained in an online think tank forum.
Most likely, drone swarms are something
you're going to see on a future battlefield. And I don't think it's if. As a matter of fact, I think we're already seeing some of it. I just think it's a matter of when you begin to see it.
And feeding the momentum of this potential arms race, in order to fight these weapons, you need these weapons. Humans don't have a chance.
When you're defending against a drone swarm, that a human may be required to make that first decision, but I'm just not sure any human can keep up with a drone swarm, defending against a drone swarm.
This issue of speed gets us to a critical emerging danger of autonomous weapons.
The weapons we've seen so far are capable of a high degree of autonomy, but they wouldn't be impossible for humans to control. Even a fire-and-forget weapon needs a human to fire it. They're still operating in a way that we can pretty much grasp. Now let's think ahead, a decade or two into the future. That's a decade or two of rampant technological development and adoption of increasingly autonomous weapons.
I think what is very likely that in 20 years' time, we will have swarms of unmanned systems, not even necessarily just airborne, just drones, can also be ground systems, surface vessels, etc. So different units operating together and carrying out attacks together, which does indeed require quite a high level of AI-enabled autonomy.
To fight these systems, you will need these systems because human beings are simply too slow.
This is what potentially may drive an arms race, that some actors may be forced to adopt a certain level of autonomy, at least defensively, because human beings would not be able to deal with autonomous attacks as fast as would be necessary. So speed is definitely a big concern here.
And that could have fateful consequences for how wars begin.
We could find ourselves in a situation where, because of this problem of speed and autonomous systems having to be countered by other autonomous systems, we could find ourselves in a situation where these systems basically react to each other in a way that's you know, not wanted. In the literature we call this flash wars, where you have an attack, or even just that you think that there is an attack, an autonomous system reacts to that, another autonomous system by the opponent reacts to that attack, and you kind of have this escalation potentially very fast, hence the flash wars, where you basically have an accidental military conflict that you didn't want.
We've already seen something quite like this on the financial markets. The flash crash of 2010 wiped more than $1 trillion off the US stock markets in just minutes. It was driven by trading algorithms feeding off each other in a dizzying spiral. How it happened is still not fully understood.
In a flash crash, trading could be halted to prevent disaster. The risk with a flash war is that there might be no pulling back.
If the kind of beginning is bad enough, it may not even matter anymore that the original event wasn't supposed to be an attack in the first place, but you could have a situation where the counterattack is so bad that you end up in a war.
Now think back to Nagorno-Karabakh, a regional war where autonomous weapons may have tipped the balance. In a future world, with the risk of flash war, places like this could face even more instability. Even more conflict.
I think we are moving into a world where systems will be more autonomous, but we need to make sure that we minimize the risk of unwanted escalation, of lethality decided by machines without any human control.
But how do we do that? How do we prevent the worst? As we're about to find out, the world is struggling to find a way.
My fear is that there will be more unpredictability in how we get to armed conflict. So the pathways to the battlefield won't be clear to policymakers. So they will not understand fully the risks of certain actions or certain happenings. And that'll make the whole world a more dangerous place.
Amandeep Singh Gill was at the center of United Nations efforts to try to get a grip on autonomous weapons, a process that critics say is now on the brink of failure. This is where it all happens, the UN buildings in Geneva. It's here that delegates from UN member states gather with experts and NGOs to talk about the future of autonomous warfare. This process is part of what's called the UN Convention on Certain Conventional Weapons, a diplomatic tongue twister launched in the 1980s to try to regulate non-nuclear weapons that were deemed so dangerous that they needed special attention. Things like landmines and blinding lasers. In 2014, lethal autonomous weapons made it onto their agenda. It's been very slow going. The process has yielded a set of guiding principles, saying that autonomous weapons should be subject to human rights law and that humans must have ultimate responsibility for their use. But these guiding principles have no force. They're just a basis for more discussions. And for campaigners calling for a ban, that's not enough.
We do get frustrated by the delays that have happened and the delay in moving from discussions to actual negotiations of a new treaty. The main problem with this forum is that it operates by consensus, so meaning any one state can block progress and block that shift from discussions to negotiations.
Bonnie Doherty lectures on human rights at Harvard Law School and is also a spokeswoman for the Campaign to Stop Killer Robots, a high-profile coalition of NGOs. She's mapped out principles for an international treaty.
The overarching obligation of the treaty should be to maintain meaningful human control over the use of force. It should be a treaty that governs all weapons with operating with autonomy that choose targets and fire on them based on sensors inputs rather than human inputs.
That idea of keeping meaningful human control is broadly echoed by many countries, but only 30 states support the campaign. They're mostly smaller nations, but include one giant in the form of China. But Beijing's true position is blurred.
China has called for a ban on, or expressed support for a ban on use, but hasn't, to my knowledge, expressed a support for a ban on development and production. So we believe that you need to prohibit development as well as use of these inherently problematic systems, because once things are developed, the genie's out of the bottle.
And the other great military powers aren't at all keen on those sorts of limitations either. Russia is accused of taking any opportunity to thwart the Geneva talks process. But there are plenty of other objectors too.
Russia has been particularly vehement in its objection. Some of the other states developing autonomous weapon systems, such as Israel, the US, UK and others have certainly been unsupportive of a new treaty and, you know, have been expressed varying degrees of support for actually continuing discussions. So those are some of the roadblocks that we faced.
As things stand, the US is highly unlikely to support a ban. Rather, it set out its own principles, which include human involvement.
A ban on autonomous weapon systems is essentially infeasible just because the technology is out there. The Department of Defense has been very clear about its commitment to ethical uses of these technologies, where right now the position is that a human being has to be on the loop or in the loop when those weapons are used, so that it won't be fully autonomous in the sense that there won't be any human interaction with these weapon systems.
But the reality is that the US, China, and Russia are all competing so intensely in all areas of AI technology that it's questionable whether any of them would sign up to a treaty that significantly limits what they can do.
The large powers will always have agendas. You know, they want freedom of maneuver. They think that they need to have agency over technology development. And sometimes they've been very skeptical of the role of international organizations, multilateral forums, in understanding and regulating technology.
Aside from the lack of interest from crucial players, the challenge of tackling an intangible technology like AI is genuinely difficult.
A lot of the old ways of arms control and arms control treaties don't work anymore and don't apply anymore to these systems, because we are, to put it kind of bluntly, we're talking about software rather than hardware. So a lot of arms control systems in the past basically were about, you know, allocating a certain number of systems. You know, you are allowed 100 warheads of this type, and you are allowed 100 warheads of this type, and we're basically counting. You can't do this with the AI-enabled weapon systems that we were talking about, because it doesn't matter what it looks like from the outside, but what's in there.
Germany has been quite active in trying to navigate around these problems. Its foreign minister says that the world has to find a way.
Just like we managed to do with nuclear weapons over many decades, we have to forge international treaties on new weapons technologies.
Heiko Maas is a member of Germany's Social Democrats and has been a vocal advocate of arms control.
They need to make clear that we agree that some developments that are technically possible are not acceptable and must be prohibited globally.
In fact, the German government has laid out its intention in the document that underpins the current coalition. It says, we reject autonomous weapon systems that are outside human control. We want to prohibit them worldwide. Now, it sounds pretty clear, but even this is complicated. Germany, for instance, does not support the campaign to stop killer robots. It says there's a better way.
We don't reject it in substance. We're just saying that we want others to be included in the global controls that we would need to ensure that autonomous weapon systems don't come into use. So military powers that are technologically in a position not just to develop autonomous weapons, but also to use them, we need to include them.
So this isn't just a debate about the rights and wrongs of autonomous weapons. It's also a debate about process.
On the one hand, Germany says that the big powers must be on board for any agreement. They want that elusive consensus in the Geneva process. On the other hand, the campaign to stop killer robots says that the matter is too urgent to wait. They say there's only time for one more round in Geneva.
And we feel that if states don't take action by, you know, at that point, that they should consider strongly, they should move outside of the Convention on Conventional Weapons and look at other options. So they could go to the UN General Assembly to negotiate a treaty, they could start an independent process, basically a forum that is not bound by consensus, but it is, you know, guided by states that actually are serious about this issue and willing to take develop strong standards to regulate these weapon systems.
There is precedent for this, with landmines, for example. In the 1990s, the Geneva process couldn't find consensus. Instead, more than 100 countries broke away to create a ban called the Ottawa Convention.
But the great powers didn't sign, and more than 20 years later, the US, Russia, and China still haven't joined the Ottawa Convention.
It's a dilemma, isn't it? So you can do away with the rule of consensus, and then you can have results quickly, but they will not have near universal support. At the very least, they will not have support from the countries that are developing these capabilities. But through the rule of consensus, you force those countries to engage. So I think it's a choice that the international community makes in these forums.
So the world doesn't agree on what to do about autonomous weapons, and it can't even agree on how to agree on what to do about them. In this situation, is there any prospect of a solution?
I think in the end, we may end up with rules or norms or indeed agreements that are more focused on specific uses and use cases rather than specific systems or technology. So where you basically agree, for example, to use certain capabilities only in a defensive way or only against machines rather than humans or only in certain contexts. But as you can imagine, implementing that, first of all, agreeing to that and then implementing that is just much harder than some of the older arms control agreements.
Compounding this is the rock bottom level of trust between the major powers right now. U.S.-China talks in Alaska in early 2021 descended into a bitter round of accusations.
When there is lack of trust, you tend to attribute all kinds of intentions to the other party, and you tend to overestimate what they might be doing and overshoot in terms of your own response. And today, frankly, the developments on the technology front are actually adding to the mistrust.
And as the world slips deeper into this era of great power competition, the challenge will be for the big three to carve out areas like this, where they can put mutual interest above the visceral drive to be on top. That is the spirit of arms control.
You don't make arms control agreements with your best friends and allies. You always, by definition, you know, try to negotiate them with your enemies. And this isn't exactly new. I don't think it's impossible that, you know, these players which are already opponents and may eventually become even more adversarial can come together and agree on certain minimum requirements simply because it is in everyone's interest.
For Germany's foreign minister, the whole world has responsibility here.
The world must take an interest in the fact that we're moving towards a situation with cyber or autonomous weapons where everyone can do as they please. We don't want that.
Climate change serves as an ominous warning of what can happen when humanity sees a common threat on the horizon, but fails to act in time to stop it.
The Rio summit kicked off the UN's process of talks to tackle climate change way back in 1992. It took 23 years to get to the Paris Agreement, and it's clear even that wasn't enough. It's already too late to prevent much of the devastation that scientists predicted right from the start.
With the scenarios we've just seen, the warning signs are just as clear, and if anything, even more urgent.